Mrs. Lauren to intervene. Madame, you have the floor.
Okay. Thank you very much for organizing this meeting and for our opportunity to intervene. I'm speaking as a part of the women's major group. So these last 2 weeks alone have seen difficult conversations around finance. The UNSG himself said at the FFD forum, financing is the fuel for development, and yet many countries are running on empty. If adequate and suitable financing is not made available for already cash-strapped developing countries to implement their national climate plans, there's no way for the planet to stay within the 1.5 degrees warming limit. Climate finance has its origins in the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities. We also have the polluters pay principle and the do no harm principle. Now, while all states have a shared obligation to avert, minimize, and address the impacts of the climate crisis, the distribution of this responsibility is by no means equal. Some have caused the climate crisis to a far greater degree than others, having built and enriched their economies at the expense of natural resource extraction and labor exploitation. Developed countries have a historical responsibility of emissions to support developing countries. There is lack of progress around climate action because, as the discussions yesterday said, the MOI, the means of implementation, is MIA. It's missing in action. Now, COP15 agreed on new and additional finance commitments, separate and in addition to existing development aid commitments that remain unmet to date, thereby constituting an aid debt from north to south. At COP26, developed countries acknowledged they had fallen short on their promise to mobilize $100 billion a year by 2020. Now, this inadequacy of financial resources is not the only driving wedge in terms of climate finance conversations. We identify some more, you know, that we can add on to this mix. Number one, most of climate finance reported by developed countries actually come from their ODA budgets, which have been double or even triple counted. Number two, much of this climate finance has been delivered in the form of loans instead of grants, thus increasing developing countries' debt burden. Around 70% goes to mitigation projects that guarantee returns on investments for huge corporations rather than on initiatives from communities and small and medium enterprises that build resilience against climate shocks, despite, again, an agreement on balanced funding for both mitigation and adaptation, and now for loss and damage. We're also concerned over the surge of interest in blended finance for climate action, as well as different debt restructuring schemes. These are mostly mitigation-centric projects when the needs of developing countries and peoples are on adaptation and rebuilding after extreme climate shocks. And we're also deeply worried that the loss and damage fund under a World Bank model may not be the most ideal for rebuilding, reconstruction, and rehabilitation of affected countries and communities. Loss and damage goes beyond the existing scope of conversations and processes for adaptation, humanitarian emergency support, disaster risk reduction, and poverty reduction. So for us in the Women's Major Group, and I guess civil society and social movements, before we get further distracted looking for innovative approaches to plug the leaks in climate finance, we need to make sure that the primary instrument or mechanism to mobilize resources to support developing countries is delivered as a matter of obligation. Climate finance is the fundamental issue of justice. It's therefore imperative that finance is offered in full cost grants without any accessibility restrictions, such as those based on developing country income or aid eligibility classifications. It is both unjust and untenable to ask developing countries and people to take on more debt or depend on private sector finance in order to address the impacts of a crisis that they historically have done very little to create. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this strong advocacy, and I think that it's really useful also that it could be said like that in order to really put focus on very specific unequal and maybe unjust transition, and my colleague will certainly